Apple is set to announce the first Apple Silicon Mac in just a few days. Here's what we know and what we don't know. Stick around. Hey everyone, welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Julia Boship, and I'm here, as always, with Computerworld Executive Editor Ken Mingus, as well as Macworld Senior Writer Michael Simon. I mean, by and large, the biggest news story of the last week is, of course, Apple's event on November 10th. I'm sure we can all agree
on that. There's nothing else happening in the world except that.
I was just going to say, outshining even the election in the United States. Here.
Everything
it's all about
else
Apple
is nothing. It's just Apple.
Yeah.
But we should note, this is at least a week earlier than we really thought it was going to happen.
Exactly. A week. We thought the 17th, we got on the 10th.
Yeah.
Or whatever that's worth.
And you know, we don't know a lot, but we're getting some details about what we think they're going to announce, including a 16-inch MacBook Pro. I'm kind of interested to hear about that one.
Yeah. 13-inch Air, 13-inch Pro, 16-inch Pro. That's out of Bloomberg, Mark Gurman, who's pretty plugged in. So that's probably what we're going to get. He says iMacs are down the road. We heard that rumor about a massively redesigned iMac way back in June with an iPad Pro type design with a very slim bezels around rounded corners on the screen, XDR, all that other stuff. So I wouldn't look for that probably next year. But yeah, it looks like the entire laptop line will get revamped. And we also heard rumors earlier of a new MacBook, which has been retired for a couple of years now, but maybe not this time around. Maybe that'll January, February, March, who knows?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I didn't think when they retired the MacBook that it was gone for good.
No,
it makes sense.
Yeah.
Makes sense that they'd bring this out now. It's interesting too. One of the things that sort of surprised me a little bit was that at least the speculation is that there's, you know, also some design changes. I mean, I guess when you think about it, not a surprise, depending on what Apple can do with its silicon and, you know, in terms of form factor. But I'm assuming they'd be relatively minor, not major form factor changes. But that sort of piqued my interest.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a laptop. I mean, there's not a whole lot you can do with the form factor.
Cool new colors. Blue.
You need a keyboard, you need a trackpad, you need a screen. The one change I would look for is a Face ID. True depth camera that's sorely missing from the Mac line. And I don't know why Apple hasn't added it yet. With the iPhone, had it now for four generations. It is perfect for the MacBook. You open it up, you look at the thing all the time. It's just tailor-made. They have a Touch ID sensor, which is nice, but Face ID for purchasing and for obviously unlocking would be awesome.
You mean basically like it works on like the iPad?
Yeah, right. Or the iPhone. Yeah. You know, same thing. It's just, you know,
you look
built into the bezel. It's a camera, so you open it up and you're automatically logged in because it sees your face and it's that much quicker. You don't have to reach up and touch the touch bar or type in your password.
What do we think about pricing?
I mean, I'd like to think that it's going to go down, like $799 MacBook Air.
Oh, Michael, you're so optimistic.
Well, I mean, look at the pricing for Apple's other things. You know, they still have this reputation as being this really super high-end luxury, out of reach company. And you know, they're not that, but they're also not that. Because like, if you look at Samsung, for example, their Galaxy Note 20 Ultra is $1,300. The Apple's iPhone 12 Pro Max is $1,099. And Apple's prices are extremely aggressive when you look at it in line with the rest of the world. And the reason why is because they control the silicon. Samsung pays a ton to Qualcomm to use the Snapdragon processor. Google, same thing. In fact, with Google's latest phones, they said, you know what, we're not even using the new one because it's too expensive. We're going to use the step down processor, the 765G, which also has 5G, because you know Google can kind of get away with that because people buy it for the Android experience, not so much the speed experience. But the message there is that Qualcomm is charging a lot in licensing fees to these companies for these chips, and Apple doesn't have that to worry about. I don't know what Apple pays Intel. I don't know what that whole thing. No one is privy to that. But I can tell you what, it's less. If Apple's making it themselves, they're already making these chips for the iPhone and the iPad. It's not like they're building a whole new factory to make, you know, to fab chips. They're there. So whatever Apple is going to put inside these Macs, it's going to be cheaper on their bottom line than Intel.
Yeah.
Whether that's, you know, material or something that we don't even see, I don't know what it is. But I tell you what, a $799 MacBook Air would be sweet.
Oh yeah, I'm not arguing. I actually agree with you. I think Apple can. I think it would have the, you know, the room to keep those margins up because the cost of what it's doing of building these itself with its own silicon will save it some money. I'm just not sure that Apple actually will. Apple always loves to like add features and keep the price generally when they're doing a new model, at least, you know, pretty much where they were before.
They like that 30% margin.
Yeah.
And they'll do what they have to do to get there. Last year, they cut the price of the 11. This year, they, you can say they technically raised it on the 12, but they also, they brought in that 12 mini. They took out the power adapter. They'll do what they have to do to get to that 30 to 35% margin. That's their baseline. They don't necessarily say, okay, fine, we have to build a $1,400 laptop. Let's figure that out. They say we have to build a laptop and we got to make 30% on it somehow. Now, with these new chips and with the new designs and what they're allowed to do internally with the new chip could lead to lower prices. I agree with you. Probably not right now. But, you know, then again, maybe they just released the iPad Air for $600. That's more than last year. But if you compare it to the Pro, it's $200 less. And there's a lot of similarities there. Meanwhile, they sell a $350 keyboard for it. Like I said, it's about margins.
You got to accessorize, baby. Yeah, it's all about the accessories.
They're not going to not make something that they want to make because it's too expensive. They'll just, you know, look at HomePod, perfect example. They you know, at the time they were making it, $299 was the price for them to hit their margin. Then they cut it as the components got cheaper, and now they're selling the $100 one. So, you know, it could take a year to get there, but I do think that this will lead to Macs that are extremely competitive with not just super high-end Windows machines, but also, you know, mid-range. I doubt they'll compete in that super low $350 space, but I mean, who knows? They have the iPhone SE. Maybe they'll build like a plastic MacBook or something, and they'll sell like a $399 Mac. I don't know. Maybe.
And probably pretty popular. Any idea, you know, have we seen any speculation about when these things would actually be released?
I mean, there was a story this morning about production being ramped up now. So by holiday time, yeah, I would think, you know, they sold $9 billion in Macs last quarter. So they're capable of making a lot of these things right now. Like, you know, the pandemic has kind of, across the world, that's kind of settled. So they're able to churn these things out quick. And if they're starting the production now, I mean, I would think November 10th, a couple of weeks later, maybe less. I mean,
I would guess, again, we're guessing here, but I would think they'd want to get them actually into the stores before Thanksgiving.
US. That makes sense. Yeah. And, you know, again, the A14 chip that it's going to be based on, it's going to be a little bit different, but it's based on that architecture. That's all done, and that plant is running, and those chips are probably ready to go. If it's a very similar design to the current MacBook, it's not going to take that much of a shift in production to put these things together. Listen, I don't know what I'm really talking about.
Well, we'll I mean, yes,
I'm
you
not,
do.
I'm
you
not,
do.
I'm not an operations guy. But, you know, just based on my observations, Apple usually announces Macs and ships them pretty quickly, within like a week less, maybe.
I'm hoping by end of, if the announcement is on, what, Tuesday the 10th, then I'm hoping for like by that following Friday.
Could be.
You know, and maybe even immediate availability. Who knows?
Yeah, so, I mean, it might.
So I've just got one quick question for you guys. It's, you know, there's a lot that's maybe unknown about, you know, the specifics of when it comes to price, what have you. But, you know, one thing that we do know for certain, well, nearly certain, is that at this event, an Apple Silicon Mac will be announced. So are all of these additions to the Mac lineup going to have Apple Silicon? Some of them? What do you guys think?
Yeah, I mean, they're going to support Intel for a while, but it's not going to, they're not going to make new Intel Macs anymore, at least not from what I understand Apple to be doing. So yeah, all of the Macs released on Tuesday or announced on Tuesday, they'll all have Apple Silicon. They're going to have different processors from based on what I've read and based on what I understand. Like the low-end MacBook Air might have the same A14 that's in the iPad. The MacBook Pro might have an A14 T or something.
X or Z or whatever it is.
Some letter to distinguish that this is faster and maybe has an extra core or two, whatever, however it goes. But yeah, they're not going to say, here's the MacBook Air with Apple Silicon and also the Apple MacBook Air with without Apple Silicon. Like I don't see that happening. The Intel's done. They'll sell off whatever they sell. They'll make whatever they have. Like the iMacs obviously still have the Mac Pro until those models get replaced. And they're also going to support them for years to come. But the days of a new Intel Core 10 or Core 11, whatever they're up to, not Core, generation, whatever the heck the Intel processors are on, you're not going to see them in a Mac.
No, that's it. We're end of an era.
Yeah.
It really is.
What's interesting about this event is it's the One More Thing event, which if you're steeped in Apple culture, that's a loaded term, if you will. Steve Jobs used it all the time to unveil like some big thing at the end of a keynote, just when you thought it was over. We have one more thing for you. I don't know if it necessarily means anything other than the fact that this is the third event of the fall. And they're like, oh, by the way, we have one, like this is the one more thing, the Apple Mac, but it could also mean that there's other things coming out with the computers. Maybe those AirPod Studio, maybe the AirTags that we've heard about for months and years. We'll see. You know, just Macs.
I would be surprised. I mean, my gut tells me they really want to focus on Apple Silicon and the Mac lineup. And the reason for that is anything else that they announce would likely get lost in the noise, you know, around the new Macs. So I guess we'll find out in a few days.
If it's like a pair of high-end AirPods that they don't really expect to sell in major numbers anyway, maybe they'll drop that first and then go to the Macs. But yeah, it's going to be very Mac heavy. It's going to be very demo heavy. It's going to be very Craig Federighi heavy, which is awesome.
That's my favorite part of the show.
We missed him at the iPhone and the Apple Watch event. So it'll be good to have him back.
Yeah.
We'll hear about Big Sur and how this all plays. We'll hear about the new Rosetta and how the old Mac apps run. We'll hear about how iPad apps can run now. Like there's a lot for Apple to get into. So yeah, if it's an hour, which is what they've been, 50 minutes of it's going to be about this, maybe even all of it, because
I'm ready.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more excited about this than I was the iPhone 12, because for one, we knew a lot about the iPhone 12. For two, this is a big deal. You know, Apple is going to be the first for the first time in its long history of making computers, it can really do whatever it wants to do. It's not beholden to the speeds and the timeline and the roadmap of someone else, with the exception of some, you know, components here and there that aren't a big deal. If you control, as it's shown with the iPhone and the iPad, if you control the processor, you can do some pretty amazing stuff. So I'm interested to see what, I don't know if we'll see it on Tuesday, but within a year, maybe two, there's going to be some pretty cool things happening with the Mac.
You know, before we go, real quick, slightly random thought here. You
is were it talking about Pennsylvania? About,
no. No, it's actually about the iPhone 12 Pro and components. That's what made me think about it. Yeah. I just wondered if you'd seen that, you know, apparently the Pro 12, the 12 Pro is more popular than Apple thought. It's running out of parts and it's having to, like, you know, cannibalize some iPads for power management chips, I think. It's sort of a surprise. And again, it reinforces the point you were just making, is that once Apple is not as reliant on outside companies for these parts, it gives it much more flexibility, both in terms of design and, you know, how it does what it does, release schedules. It's no longer tied to other companies, and in this case, in particular, Intel. So yeah, it's going to be interesting to watch what it does.
Yeah, and you know, the processor is obviously the heart of the thing, the brains of it. Like that's the thing that you need to start with. And if Intel isn't, I mean, you know, for all intents and purposes, Intel never really lived up to the promise Apple. It started that way, But Intel's really dragged its feet. It's still on a, I think, 11 nanometer process. Like it's even been trumped by AMD now in a lot of cases. And it's, you know, it's, they're struggling a bit, and losing Apple isn't going to help that. You know, when Apple, especially if these computers like are mind-blowingly fast, which they very well could be because the iPhone is, Intel has a lot of soul searching to do right now. They got to figure stuff out. They whiffed on the 5G modem that they were building for Apple, basically, and that fell apart. Their desktop PCs aren't, you know, industry leading or as industry leading as they once were, and now they're losing. Apple isn't the biggest client they have by any stretch, but they're Apple. When Apple jumps ship, people notice. So there's a lot of storyline ahead for this. This is, I mean, I think it's suffice to say this is Apple's last processor transition. After now, this is the third major one, and this is it. Like, however long the Mac is alive or around, they're going to have Apple Silicon processors. So this is like, we can bank on this being it. Like with Intel, you weren't quite so sure. This is it. Apple's the Mac now, this is the future and forever of the Mac. And I'm curious to see where it goes.
So you're saying this is the biggest news to emerge out of the US this week?
This year, oh, for sure. This week, this year. Yeah.
Okay.
Transformative. Well, thank you both so much for calling in and chatting with me. I'm sure we're going to have obviously much more information next week after the event, so we can check back then. And if any of our viewers here have any questions about Apple Silicon, I'll be linking a few previous episodes of Today in Tech that Ken, Mike, and I discussed Apple Silicon on. So that'll give you some background info if you're curious. Thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you liked this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon in the corner so you're notified every single time we post a new video. If you have any questions, comments, if you're excited about an Apple Silicon Mac, if you're not excited about it, let me know in the comments. I'm interested to hear your thoughts. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time.